Welcome to the third session in the webinar series, Care of Diverse Elders and Their Families in Primary Care, sponsored by the Stanford Geriatric Education Center in collaboration with the California Area Health Education Centers, American Geriatric Society, and Natividad Medical Center. My name is Chris Matola, and I will be your host for the session. We are very happy to have you join with us today as we present the program on depression and mental health. If you have questions during the presentation, please use the chat feature on the screen to write your questions. The presenters will respond to the questions in the Q&A session at the end of their presentations. If you need to communicate with the presenters directly after the session, you may do so by sending an email to Stanford GEC at stanfordgec@stanford.edu. At the conclusion of the webinar, please complete the short evaluation questionnaire. For those of you who have requested continuing education credits for attending the webinar, the evaluation is required. We need to let you know, we need to let you know that the webinar is not supported by any commercial interest, and today's presenters have no financial relationships to disclose. Today's session will be presented by Drs. Dolores Gallagher-Thompson and Dr. Rita Hargrave. Rita Hargrave, MD, is a board-certified geriatric psychiatrist at the Veterans Administration Martinez Outpatient Mental Health Clinic and consulting psychiatrist at the University of California Davis Alzheimer's Disease Center. She is a member of the volunteer faculty in the Department of Psychiatry at University of California, Davis, and a member of the Ethnogeriatrics Committee of the American Geriatric Society. She has been a prolific contributor to journals, magazines, and books exploring neuropsychiatry, cross-cultural psychiatry, and ethnic minority caregivers. She founded www.ethnicelderscare.net, a website focused on ethnicity and dementia. Dolores Gallagher-Thompson, Ph.D., APBB, received her doctorate in clinical psychology with a concentration in adult development and aging from the University of Southern California in 1979. Since that time, she has been a funded researcher in the areas of late-life depression, stress, and family caregiving and ethnicity and dementia caregiving. Currently, she is professor of research in the Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences, Stanford University School of Medicine, and director of the Stanford Geriatric Education Center. She is a licensed psychologist and sees patients at the Gero Psychiatry Outpatient Clinic at Stanford. She also serves in several volunteer positions with the Alzheimer's Association in Northern California and is currently developing online intervention programs for caregivers of older persons with significant memory loss. She has published numerous books and peer-reviewed journal articles in her areas of expertise. And now for our speakers. Okay, so...
Okay, this is Dr. Hargrave. I'd like to start today's presentation just based on identification and treatment of late-life depression in ethnically diverse older adults. Now, one of the first areas to start off with is why is it important to recognize and treat late-life depression? I'd like to start with a case history. This is a composite case, a case history of Mrs. Rodriguez, a 70-year-old Filipino-American woman. She's widowed and a retired housekeeper. And when she went to her primary care doctor, her symptoms were initial insomnia, early morning awakening. She was irritable and felt tired a lot. She had also complained of headaches, low back pain for the past 5 years. Her medical history was positive for hypertension, diabetes, reflux, post-MI, stroke, and post-CABG. Now, her previous primary care doctor had treated her with Prozac, but she'd stopped it after only a week. Her medications at the time of her first visit were cimetidine, atenolol, hydrochlorothiazide, digoxin, and oxycodone. So sort of a typical clinic patient. Now, why would it be important to screen her for depression? Also, what are her risk factors for depression? What other disorders should be included in the differential for depression? What are likely barriers to Mrs. Rodriguez receiving treatment? And if Mrs. Rodriguez does have depression, what issue should her primary care physician discuss with her about the diagnosis? So these are the things we're going to talk about in the next few minutes. Now, why should Mrs. Rodriguez be screened? Well, the biggest reason is depression is extremely common among medically ill elders. Depression is the second most common medical illness after hypertension. Surveys suggest that 50%, and I'd actually say that a higher percentage than that, of primary care patients with depression go undiagnosed. Primary care providers provide about 50% of the outpatient care for depressed patients. And in systems outside of the one like I work in with the VA, which really does screen for depression on a regular basis and has a pretty active mental health service, I'd say in most settings where there isn't psychiatric availability, ready access to primary care providers, probably closer to 60 to 70% of outpatients are treated by primary care doctors. Now, why should she be screened for depression? The prevalence rates for depression in older adults vary according to residence. It's estimated 5 to 9% are seen in primary care clinics, 20 to 30% are seen in institutional settings, and moving even more, it's more prevalent in nursing homes and among hospitalized elders, so 10 to 43% are projected to have depression. Now, these rates are even higher among women and among elderly Latinos. The highest suicide rates among minority elders are actually among Asian women. So Mrs. Rodriguez has a number of risk factors associated with depression. She is female. She has a prior history of depression, as was evidenced by her prior treatment by her primary care doctor with Prozac. She also reports chronic pain and has multiple physical symptoms. Another risk factor to be concerned about are chronic illnesses that have a high comorbidity with depression, like diabetes, coronary artery disease, and obesity. Other medical disorders that have a high comorbidity with depression are dementia, stroke, and seizures. Now, in the differential diagnosis for depression, there are a number of medical disorders that need to be considered. Thyroid disease, both hyper and hypothyroidism, can appear to give you symptoms that look like depression. One also has to be concerned about alcohol or substance abuse in the elderly. Dementia, delirium, electrolyte, and hematological imbalances can give you symptoms that are suggestive of depression. Things like sleep problems, concentration problems, fatigue, those can appear in those disorders, but they actually are symptoms of depression. Other disorders that have a high comorbidity with depression and have to be considered are Parkinson's disease, stroke, seizures. Also, medications can give a picture that looks like depression. Beta blockers and steroids both can produce symptoms that are suggestive of depression. Now, in terms of what's relevant for ethnic elders, the common cultural barriers to Mrs. Rodriguez receiving treatment can fall roughly into two categories. There are physician factors that would make it difficult for her to receive treatment. This is assuming we have a physician who is from a different ethnic background than Mrs. Rodriguez, and there are patient factors that can often wreak havoc with minority patients getting adequate assessment and treatment for depression. Physician factors include a perceived lack of time. I know that in most clinics, the average length of time the patients are actually seen is anywhere from 5 to 7 minutes, maybe less depending on how things are going. There's also a referral bias. If the primary care physician or the medical team doesn't have ready access to mental health, if not outright treatment consultation, people will not do it because it's difficult to get the appropriate referral sources. Prescribing practices. There are a number of studies that have noted that minority elders and minorities in general are less likely to be treated with the most up-to-date and most efficacious antidepressants. There's an unfortunate bias to using older medications with greater side effects. as I mentioned before, limited access to mental health consultation can make it more difficult for the primary care providers to get ready access to mental health treatment. Finally, there's a very limited research on the diagnosis and effective treatment strategies in ethnic elders around depression. So patient factors that also need to be considered are cultural attitudes, that many ethnic groups don't believe that depression is a legitimate illness. There's a lot of stigma associated to it, so they're less likely to report some of the symptoms that we would think of are associated with depression. Depression in many ethnic groups also presents as physical complaints. There's, I mentioned before, stigma is an issue. Language is also an issue, because it's often much easier for bilingual patients to reflect and articulate emotional issues in the language that they were brought up in. It's a lot more difficult to access that information if you're translating it into a second language. So many times they just won't even try. Finally, people have often used other support networks before seeing physicians and mental health workers. There may be folk healers, people in their faith community who they consult before they see us. This is a sort of an example of some of the culturally based attitudes around depression that we've seen both in African Americans and also Latinos. In this survey, 63% of folks thought that depression was a sign of personal weakness. Another 68% didn't believe that depression was a legitimate health problem. And among the for the elderly, 56% actually thought depression was a normal part of aging. So these are all reasons why patients might not bring up symptoms of depression or might not accept the idea that they may be suffering from depression. Now, at what point should Mrs. Rodriguez be referred to a mental health specialist if she requests psychological therapies? And there are patients who would prefer to go into a support group or talk therapy as opposed to medications. If there's active suicidal ideation, if the patient has symptoms of mania as part of a bipolar disorder, and there's a substantial percentage of patients who will have their first manic episodes in late life, if there are symptoms of psychosis, delusions, hallucinations, two other reasons why mental health specialists should be involved is if there's comorbid substance abuse or another psychiatric disorder, and finally, treatment-resistant depression. If there's been an effort made to treat the depression and the first go-around hasn't been successful. Once a physician, and I keep saying physician, but the person on the primary care team, if that person agrees that Mrs. Rodriguez has depression, what kinds of things should they be discussing with her? At the top of the list, really educating her about what depression is. And there's a lot of websites and there's a lot of handouts that can be had that can be helpful with clarifying what depression is and what it isn't. Educating and discussing with Mrs. Rodriguez what some of the treatment options are, be it talking therapy or antidepressants or a combination of the two. And finally, another issue that needs to be discussed is the availability of psychological treatments and the need for psychiatric assessment, because there may be situations where something else needs to happen in addition to what the treatment plan is that's laid out by the primary care team. And at this point, I'd like to move over to the videotape, which puts a little bit more meat on the bones of this discussion.
Sorry about that. There's some technical issues here and there. We're going to have a Q&A chat right now, and we can talk about some of the things we just heard right now. I'm going to turn it over to Rita.
They covered a lot of information in that short video, and I think they highlighted a number of the key issues with minority elders, both in terms of stigma and ambivalence about mental health issues, the connection of faith communities. And I'm wondering if these situations sound familiar to folks, if there are people who've run into that, not only around the treatment of depression, but also around other medical illnesses where people's cultural beliefs and their faith beliefs are not quite in line with what we're suggesting. So welcome any questions about what we've done, gone over so far. It's a very, very topical and timely issue because our population, especially in California, continues to grow and get more diverse over time. And the more that we can be sort of aware of these cultural issues, the better we're able to respond to it. I see one question here. Is it possible to purchase the video that we saw? It's called Gray and Blue, and I think it actually is available online, but you should email us and we can give you more specifics about how to get hold of it, because it's very well done. Any other questions about some of the issues that this raised? And maybe something that you'll see in the future. I see a few more questions coming in. Okay, take one last question. The most difficult issue for me is that we have no geriatricians in our area, at least that don't work with Medicaid. And I think that's true nationally. There are very few people who specialize in geriatrics. The bulk of treatment for both medical and psychiatric issues are from general adult physicians and healthcare providers. So we encourage people to, and you'll hear more about the treatment adjustments that you make, but you end up using the same medications for older adults that you do for younger adults. It's just a matter of lower dosing. But I think even before we get to that point, it really needs to be on everyone's mind that depression screening should be done on most older adults, and particularly if they have more complicated medical problems. And we will hold your questions and maybe get back to them a little bit later. Because I'd like to turn it over to Dr. Dolores Gallagher-Thompson.
Okay, thank you, Rita.
Okay, thank you, Rita. I would like to talk more about assessment of depression now, because it's very important that we are able to assess depression in the primary care settings effectively and efficiently. So it can be a challenging, however, when we're working with ethnically diverse elders. Why? Because culture may influence how they present themselves and how depression is expressed by older individuals. For instance, it's fairly common that the word depression is not acknowledged per se, but that other terms are used that represent depression. For example, in Latino cultures, the concept of nervios might be expressed, or imbalance in Chinese and other Asian cultures. Middle Eastern individuals might refer to problems of the heart. So how do we do the assessment? Well, we use the tools that we have available, and usually we supplement them with an interview, at least a few interview questions about the individual's state of mind, which might open them up for discussing more what they really are feeling. I'd like to mention two scales that are in common use to assess depression. They are in your handout that was emailed to you along with the slides. There was a packet sent to you which contains copies of the geriatric depression scale and the other one that I'll be talking about in the first few pages. So this one, or the GDS as it's referred to, exists in short and long forms. It's been widely used, it's well validated, easily administered, and it has strong psychometrics behind it. It has a simple yes-no format, so it can be completed by individuals with mild cognitive impairment, which is often an accompaniment of depression. But it does not assess the traditional symptoms of depression. For example, sleep problems, appetite, energy level, those kinds of things. It focuses more on the psychological aspects like negative self-worth, pessimism. But on the other side, on the positive side of the coin, it's available in many languages, as you can see here. And it is free. It can be downloaded from the website that you see here, which is also in your slides. And finally, there is a brand new feature. There is a free Android app that allows you to do the 15-item GDS on your phone, and it will automatically score it for you. Without, of course, any interpretation of the results, but it does at least serve as a brief and effective screening measure, particularly if you then supplement it with relevant questions. In the primary care setting, what's been most frequently used is the PHQ-2 for screening, which is really the first two questions of the larger instrument called the PHQ-9 that many of you may be familiar with. The two screening questions are, over the last 2 weeks, how often have you been bothered by the following: having little interest or pleasure in doing things, or feeling down, depressed, or hopeless? The response choices vary from a 0, meaning not at all, to a 3, meaning nearly every day. So if the individual scores 2 or more, i.e. screens positive, it really is recommended that they go on and complete the full PHQ-9. Using the cut score of 2, though, if you cannot do the full PHQ-9 for one reason or another, will give you a sensitivity of 0.86, meaning that 86% of those with significant depression will be correctly identified. So that's pretty good for 2 items. Can't get much briefer than that, I don't think. And in many primary care settings, people are given the PHQ-2 annually. And if they acknowledge distress, again, we'd recommend that you go on to the full PHQ-9 if you can. So the PHQ-9, a copy of that is also in the handout PDF file that was sent to you with the scoring information. What the scores refer to, as you can see here, and how that relates to treatment recommendations, which I'll talk about in a moment. So translations are available as well, and they are free, can be downloaded from the PHQ website. So a question came up, which tool do you recommend for use in the acute hospital setting? And I would recommend the PHQ-2. Because of the high sensitivity that you find with using just simply those 2 items. Now, how does it relate to treatment, which I think is kind of on everybody's mind? You might have used these screening tools before but not be quite sure how to interpret them. So it's generally considered that if the score is below 10, then probably a watchful waiting attitude is sufficient, and repeating the instrument at regular intervals is also recommended. But when you've got a score of 10 or above, then you start to wonder about what to do. And many suggest that when you get a score of 15, that's a definite. That's when you would begin treatment of one kind or another. And a score of 20 would require more immediate attention, because 20 out of 27 would represent the severe range of depression. Not very common in outpatient settings, and often really highly suggestive of recommendation to a mental health professional. Now, the VA has published extensive guidelines for the management of depression, which are similar, very close to what you just saw a moment ago. They again use 15 as the cutoff for really starting some kind of treatment, and 20 for the more severe, as the more severe indicator, and recommending the combination or multiple drugs in the case of the higher range. And they also recommend for chronic depression of moderate to severe intensity, the combination is again advised. So in a moment, we'll talk more in more detail about medications, but right now I'd like to talk a little bit about treatment decision making before we go into some of those specifics. And I'm sure we're aware, but I think sometimes it's good to reflect for a moment on the fact that the actual care a person receives is going to really be an interaction of a number of factors. First of all, what's available in the system that you're in? What are the models of care that you're using? What is the severity and the longevity of the patient's symptoms? What are the available methods? Is pharmacotherapy really available? Are any kinds of psychotherapy available? Do you have the staff? Are they trained? Can the caseloads absorb more patients and so forth? But probably for our purposes today, sociocultural factors should be underscored. We heard before about cultural beliefs about seeking help for depression and how they can slow the process down. Cultural beliefs affect what kind of treatment people are willing to accept. Then there's also the issue of accessibility of services that Dr. Hargrave brought up earlier. We might have very good services, but if they're not available in the language that the person prefers, then they will not be able to take advantage of them. And on a very straightforward level, they may not be able to get there on a regular basis to have the follow-up care that they need. So these factors need to be taken into account when working with ethnically diverse elders. And we suggest that it's very good to think in terms of when you're doing treatment planning that you use a heuristic like this LEARN model that's been around for quite a while. It was developed in 1983, and it really has been used a great deal in primary care to, as a respectful way of negotiating a treatment plan with the individual that you're working with. And the letters stand for listening, you know, with some degree of empathy, explaining your view of the problem, acknowledging and discussing that there may be different views of the problem from the patient and the patient's family. You would recommend treatment, but you probably will be also negotiating it when you're working with ethnically diverse elders. And perhaps this might bring to your mind the idea of complementary and alternative medicine and how that's going to dovetail or fit with the more standard forms of treatment. So you might be thinking about that as Dr. Hargrave continues talking about antidepressant medications.
Okay, sort of at the top of the list around antidepressant treatment, we also have to think about different types of depression. We'll discuss a little about the types of antidepressants and what goes into the selection criteria, the guidelines for antidepressant treatment, and also healthy behaviors that can help combat depression. Now, major depression, which is if you look into the DSM-4, which is the Bible for explaining and articulating psychiatric diagnoses. Major depression requires a number of physical symptoms in addition to low mood. And that's what most of the medication treatment has been based on. That is a pure form of very severe depression. Dysthymia is another common form of depression. It's not as openly severe like people's GDS scores are not going to be quite as high, but it's a sort of a low level of depression that still disables people to a great degree. Now, one of the most common forms of depression in primary care settings actually is an atypical depression where you have a combination of depression and anxiety. So people will be sad, but they will also say they feel wound up and irritable and restless. So you get a combination of the two symptoms. And finally, you'll also see depression that's a result of a particular medical condition. Certain types of cancer tend to be associated with the first onset of depression. There's a lot of neurological disorders like dementia, stroke, that can, because of the brain changes, they can actually produce depressive symptoms. Now this is a pretty up-to-date list of the most commonly used antidepressants, and they're broken down in terms of mechanisms of action. The SSRIs, which are the gold standard right now for treatment of depression, are serotonin reuptake inhibitors. That basically means they're geared towards changing neurotransmitters' response around one specific neurotransmitter, serotonin. The first one in that class that attracted a lot of attention was Prozac. That was the first one on the line probably almost 20 years ago. And since then, a number of other agents have been created, like Celexa, Zoloft, and Paxil. Now, not everyone's depression appears to be primarily mediated by serotonin. There also seem to be people that have disorders, we believe, in norepinephrine and dopamine. And we've come to that conclusion because a lot of them don't have as robust a response to serotonin reuptake inhibitors. So some other agents that have been developed that target other neurotransmitters are venlafaxine, duloxetine. Are more energizing than many of the serotonin reuptake inhibitors. People feel an energy boost with them. And the other class is norepinephrine and dopamine reuptake inhibitors, with the prime example being Wellbutrin or bupropion. You may recognize that because that's been associated with smoking cessation, but because it's working on dopamine neurotransmitters that are part of the addiction that is involved with smoking. But both of these classes, both the SNRIs and the NDRIs, tend to be more energizing antidepressants. And you have to be careful with those with older adults. At the bottom of that list are the tricyclics, and they are the older style drugs that have been around for 40 years or more. And we tend to stay away from those with older adults because of the side effect profile. They tend to be very sedating. There are a lot of drug interactions. They've been associated with increased fall risk. So in general, we encourage people to stay away from those older agents because they are much more effective antidepressants with fewer side effects. On the last group is other agents, Remeron, Amitazepine, and Trazodone, that have become increasingly popular for a variety of reasons. Trazodone is used a lot to help with sleep disorders, and mirtazapine or Remeron has been used for to improve appetite in older adults in addition to its sedating properties. So that's a rough overview of the selection of medications that are out there. Generally, what I encourage people to do is to get comfortable with one agent from each class so that if your SSRIs are not working, you have some familiarity with an alternative like a venlafaxine in another class of medications. Now, when we're talking about medication side effects, the things we're looking for are medications that have little sedative properties and are low in terms of anticholinergic activity. It's a particularly big issue for the elderly because sedation and anticholinergic activity both are associated with increased risk for falls, memory impairment, urinary retention, and a lot of drug interactions, because many people are taking medications that are already sedating. They're already taking medications that have anticholinergic activity. So we want to avoid aggravating a situation that's already there. So if you're looking at the down the list, most of the newer medicines, the citalopram on down to bupropion, are low in terms of their sedative possibilities, and that's a good thing. And you'll see, on the other hand, the older medications like Elavil tend to be high. Anticholinergic activities, again, the profile is much more favorable for the newer medications. Now, when I'm choosing an antidepressant, one of the big things that I'm looking for are what are some of the existing problems in addition to depression I'm concerned about. For instance, if I have concerns about someone having a high potential for suicide, I'm going to avoid the tricyclic antidepressants because they, in overdose, can be much more lethal than larger doses of the serotonin reuptake inhibitors. Now, in addition to the other problems, so high suicide risk, avoid tricyclic antidepressants. If someone has a combination of depression and panic attacks or anxiety symptoms, that atypical depression that I mentioned in the beginning, again, the first line medications would be serotonin reuptake inhibitors, but also venlafaxine has been found to be very effective in that combination of depression and anxiety disorders. Chronic pain is an issue, and a lot of older adults have multiple reasons for chronic pain, from arthritis, musculoskeletal problems, and that further worsens their depression. Venlafaxine, again, has been shown to be quite effective in that combination of depression and chronic pain. And duloxetine, which is a little bit more difficult to get, it's a newer medication, but that also is marketed as being particularly effective with chronic pain patients. If the concerns are weight gain, because many times obesity or weight gain associated with depression is a medical concern, we encourage people to use Wellbutrin and SSRIs because they are less likely to cause weight gain. Remeron, on the other hand, is more likely to be associated with weight gain. If we're concerned around anticholinergic activity, and that's our sensitivity because of the person's medical disorders, the medications that they're on, paroxetine, which of the serotonin reuptake inhibitors has the highest likelihood to cause anticholinergic activities, we suggest avoiding paroxetine and, of course, the older antidepressants. Orthostatic hypotension, again, is another, can be a big issue with our older adults. Many are on any hypertensive agents, and which puts them at greater risk for developing those problems. In those cases, we would lean towards nortriptyline. It's one of the few occasions on here you see a recommendation to use a tricycline, but that's been used a lot with cardiac patients over the years. But we'd encourage the use of nortriptyline, bupropion, and sertraline. Finally, sexual dysfunction is something that comes up very frequently. I've often had folks who have been on, say, Prozac or one of the other serotonin reuptake inhibitors, and as their mood starts to improve, they start recognizing that they're having issues around primarily anorgasmia with women and erectile dysfunction with men. So as opposed to adding a medication that treats sexual dysfunction, we often encourage people to switch to an antidepressant that is less likely to be associated with sexual dysfunction. And that takes us to a bupropion, nifazidone, and venlafaxine. So those are the three antidepressants that have the least likelihood to be associated with sexual dysfunction. Now, in terms of treatment guidelines for depression in the elderly, if you don't take anything else away from this talk, take this away. Start low, go slow. That's generally the approach for, you know, many medications, but I think it's particularly true for antidepressants, that whatever the lowest possible dose is, half it for older adults, and go up very slowly in terms of the dose that you're going to be aiming at as your target dose. As we said, again, avoid medications with anticholinergic and orthostatic hypotension effects. One thing that we've noticed is that sometimes a clinical response to antidepressants can take longer for older adults. In younger patients, we say don't really expect to get the full clinical response from the dose, the target dose. Say you're treating somebody with, I'll go to Celexa. If you want to get somebody up to like 20 milligrams of Celexa, titrating them up, you're not going to get the full response of that 20 milligrams until 6 weeks, 4 to 6 weeks after they've been on that. So there's a lag time. In older adults, that may even be a little bit longer. It may be more in the neighborhood of 7 to 8 weeks. So don't be try to let people know. Don't be discouraged that it just takes a while for the medications to build up in their system. Don't expect that everything is going to turn around in a week, which many times patients say that I don't feel any different in a week. It's not working, and they stop taking it. Also, the response to the mood may not be as robust in older adults because they have so many comorbid medical problems, both neurological problems and other physical problems, that where they may not feel 100% better, but hopefully there's substantial improvement. Finally, there's higher potential for side effects with antidepressants because of the other medical disorders that they're on, that they're more sensitive to medication side effects, and the possibility for drug interactions is also problematic. What happens if you've been treating somebody and you don't get the kind of response that you want, what we call treatment-resistant depression? Sometimes that's under treatment, that the dose they're on is just not high enough for them to get the best response. As just as often, though, there's the issue of people not taking medicines, just like Mrs. Rodriguez stopped taking her medicines after a week, and she may not have told her doctor about this, because I get this a lot, where people have, you know, stopped taking things and didn't tell anybody, and they're still feeling depressed, you know, years later. Patients may also stop medications because of side effects. They have other comorbid illnesses that make it difficult for them to keep taking medications for mood. And finally, there was a misdiagnosis that they may have had dementia and depression was not the issue. So if things are not working, if the usual things that you do are not working, these are some things to consider that might be contributing to it. Finally, healthy behaviors. Beyond medication, it's really important to include healthy behaviors that can help combat depression. And these are the same sorts of things that you're telling your patients anyway, but really to reinforce it in terms of these being helpful strategies to manage depression. Regular exercise. I was talking to a patient yesterday who was saying that, 2 o'clock in the afternoon, she gets tired, her mood tanks, and she starts feeling depressed. And I say, well, it would be helpful to get out of your chair, take a walk for 15 minutes, drink some water, just get on the move, because that will both reduce stress and help with mood management. Smoking cessation, sleep management, weight management. Those three are, critical for maintaining good mood and good health overall. Hydration in older adults is an enormous issue, something we don't talk about. Many of them are taking multiple medications that can cause them to feel dehydrated, and they interpret that dehydration as fatigue and depression. Socialization, being around other people, being active, being engaged in activities that you enjoy are really critical pieces of this treatment. I mean, I talk about it the same way that I talk about diabetes. Diabetes management is not just taking insulin. There's a whole lifestyle shift that needs to happen to effectively manage your diabetes. The same is true for depression. And finally, to really encourage people to make the best use of their sociocultural strengths, whether it's using extended family, including play sisters, play cousins, using religion, their church affiliations, attending services, any sort of social network that's faith-based or otherwise, and whatever spiritual supports, because many older adults will say that one of the things that gets them through hard times are prayer, reading the Bible, watching church services on TV. Those are some of the critical healthy behaviors that can help combat depression. And I have a few minutes for Q&A. I see a number of questions here. Let me address a few here. Do you consider drug interactions and polypharmacy when prescribing antidepressants? I'm fortunate within the VA in terms of having ready access for programs that can sort of look at drug interactions ahead of time. I encourage you to. There are a number of programs that are actually out there that can assess that. And whenever I'm looking at the person's the selection of antidepressants, I'm also looking at the other medications that they're on and the symptoms that they're reporting. For instance, if someone comes in and says that they feel wired up and tense all the time, I'm probably not going to move necessarily in the direction of a more activating antidepressant. I may take something that's more energy neutral, like Celexa, or something that may be a little bit more sedating. Some other questions that have come in. Okay. Okay, let's see if I can get this one. Some people fear that their concerns being known to the community members might be an issue of confidentiality. That is certainly a concern that people have. In a small community, everyone knows who goes to the doctor. And I'd say sometimes one of the things that can be really helpful is if you can discuss with the patient what aspects of their illness do they feel most comfortable talking about. For instance, the label of depression may be something that will give people a lot of concerns. But on the other hand, talk with them about what their depression is doing. Their depression is causing them to be fatigued, to have poor memory, to have poor appetite. If we sort of frame their symptoms of depression in a way that would be acceptable to them and their community, I think you can, again, let people save face around it. So I will often use the idea that the symptoms that are most problematic to the person are the ones that we sort of discuss, and I don't necessarily put the label of depression on there. Bereavement and depression, that's what's a normal bereavement versus depression? That's a huge debate that goes on. I think right now we generally are feeling that prolonged vegetative symptoms of depression, you know, past 6 months or a year. And when I say vegetative, I mean things like sleep problems, appetite problems, fatigue. If those are going on for 6 months or a year, then we're starting to wonder, is depression the issue? So, and again, that's a whole nother debate. And I think Dr. Gallagher-Thompson has some thoughts on that.
If I could add something to what Rita said, a lot of times from the psychological perspective, we'll look at feelings like guilt. For example, if the individual, what separates normal bereavement from depression, you know, what's not so normal in bereavement. So Dr. Hargrave mentioned prolonged vegetative signs. Another is prolonged psychological distress. So most people find that their depression, their crying, their feeling that there's not much, you know, not much ahead in life, it begins to dissipate in that first year or so. And certainly by the end of 2 years, those symptoms decrease in severity. But if the individual is still crying frequently, feeling bad that they didn't treat the person right at the end, maybe, or unresolved problems in the relationship that they're ruminating about, things like that, and it's still continuing beyond the 1 to 2 year mark, then generally we would think in terms of a complicated bereavement that you would want to have some additional referral for that. So normal bereavement has a lot of overlap with depression in that first year or so, and many people do respond to treatment for depression while they're undergoing normal bereavement, oftentimes because of the fact that they look so similar. But really what makes bereavement abnormal is the severity and longevity of the symptoms.
Okay, I think
In terms of the use of benzodiazepines with older adults, I try and avoid it if at all possible because, you know, it's been, again, associated with fall risk, sedation, confusion. Most of the antidepressants I've mentioned have been particularly helpful for anxiety over time. Also, we've used other things that are probably less dangerous, both things like Vistaril, Trazodone, but also looking at non-pharmacological approaches to the treatment of anxiety. So that's often the direction that I will go with older adults. Sometimes that involves just better sleep hygiene and more exercise. I think at that point I'd like to turn it over to Dr. Dolores Gallagher-Thompson.
Okay, thank you, Rita. Thanks a lot. That's a lot of information and hope it's helpful to those of you out there. I'm sure that it is. And I'd like to talk now about non-pharmacological interventions. But before I do, I'd like to show you this slide, which I hope you'll get a good laugh from. This individual, this real sad sack, he's going to the depression clinic for his treatment. But he went at the wrong time of day, because guess what? It's closed for, ironically, the happy hour. So I don't know what we could recommend to him. Come back later. All right. So in a lot of medical settings, what we find is really integrated or collaborative models of care that are becoming more and more popular. And those really are having very strong results for older adults with many mental health problems. But depression is what we're talking about today, so we'll focus on that. And you may be familiar to some degree with these studies, Impact and Prospect. We're going to talk a little bit about Impact because it does provide treatment within the primary care setting. And that's probably one reason why it got such good results, because people didn't have to be referred to a different clinic, a different set of practitioners for their care. Prospect study was focused more on recognition or detection of suicidal symptoms and thoughts and how to prevent them. So there is a discussion of the prospect study in your PDF. It's towards the end, and it also in the PDF you'll also find some other slides about warning signs for suicidality and what are some things that you can do when those warning signs occur. So we would encourage you to take a look through that PDF and get to that suicide section if that's of interest to you. And it probably should be, because suicide is common, unfortunately, among older adults. And as Dr. Hargrave said earlier, older Asian women are actually at very high risk. So let's just talk a moment about the impact study, because I think it provides a good model, which some of you may be interested in and might be able to implement in your setting. So it involved 18 primary care clinics from around the U.S., close to 2,000 participants over the age of 60 with significant depression, not minor depression, but either major or chronic depression or both. And they were randomly assigned to either intervention or control. And one of the key features in the intervention arm was that the patients had access to a depression care specialist who worked within that primary care setting. They used a stepped care model, which means that the level or the intensity of care varied according to whether or not there was a response to the earlier levels. So initially, evaluation, education, and either an antidepressant or problem-solving therapy, which I'll talk about in a minute, were used. Then if there was no response in a reasonable period of time, they were offered the other one, whichever they didn't start with, or perhaps a new medication. And if the symptoms continued, both were used simultaneously, and then finally a referral to a specialty mental health clinic if all else failed. Now, the outcomes were very positive. There was a significant improvement in depression in those in the intervention condition compared to the control group. There was more satisfaction with care. There was less severity over the course of the 12 months by the end of the time, and less functional impairment, and on the positive side, an improved quality of life. And all this was done with relatively little cost, low cost, considering the high cost that would be associated with untreated depression, which can make management of medical illnesses much more complicated. Now, collaborative care models, those were developed based on chronic disease management principles that Caton and colleagues wrote about 10 years ago, which is very popular in the treatment of many chronic physical illnesses, but it hasn't been used widely in the treatment of mental illnesses in later life. But in this model, non-physicians are given a greater role. So similar to what you just heard about in IMPACT, where there was a depression care specialist embedded in the clinic, in the collaborative care models, oftentimes if you go down to the fourth bullet point, you'll see that those that got the best results had three elements in place: a case manager who worked with the primary care physician, and the team had access to mental health specialists. So in some settings, the mental health specialists were embedded within the team. In others, they were not, but they were easily accessible. And studies that employed that model also had very good results. And for those of you that want to read more about it, there's a relatively recent meta-analysis and review in Gilbody and colleagues. And that's found in our reference section, which is towards the end of the PDF. We have given you some references on the slides, but a much more extensive reference section in the PDF, and you can go and read about all this firsthand if you want to. Now, what about complementary and alternative medicine, CAM? Well, CAM is often used by ethnic minority elders and their families, and it includes a variety of methods and systems, many of which are derived from cultural values and beliefs about health and illness and how to treat the whole person. Unfortunately, they generally have not been subjected to controlled experimental studies, and so mainstream medicine often discounts the use and the benefits of CAM. So what are some examples of CAM that have been used in treatment of depression? Well, alternative systems such as Ayurveda or acupuncture, cupping and coining, mind-body interventions, meditation, music or art therapy, shamanism, biological therapies like herbs, use of herbs, being on special diets or taking certain vitamins, manipulative and body-based therapies like chiropractic and massage, and energy therapies like Reiki, magnets, and therapeutic touch. These have all been used with elders with depression, though they are not considered part of mainstream medicine. But is it possible that mainstream medicine and CAM can coexist in the treatment of late-life depression? We obviously believe that that is the case. And in fact, if you go back to the earlier slide on the LEARN model, where we talked about negotiating a treatment plan, that's actually one of the ways in which you can really achieve a strong blend of the two, or be able to have both of them going on simultaneously in ways that are helpful to the patient. And it seems that the integration or complementarity of these two systems, it promotes trust and strengthens the relationship with the provider. And I'd like to go into some detail as well on some of the evidence-based psychotherapies. Now, you'll find a pretty thorough discussion of this also included in the PDF based on the VA guidelines. The VA and Department of Defense developed clinical practice guidelines for the management of major depression. And we've copied a few of the pages for you and put them in the PDF. We've also given you the full citation in the reference section so that you can download those guidelines yourself if you want to, the complete guidelines. But the idea here is that talking therapies or psychotherapy have also got a place in the treatment of late-life depression. Typically, though, these have to be provided by someone who is specially trained in the intervention program. And oftentimes that is unfortunately not available directly in the primary care setting, though again in the VA system that is changing somewhat. So when might you consider psychotherapy for late life depression? So if the patient requests it, when the PHQ-9 score is very high, if you're going to consider the combination of medication and psychotherapy, or if you don't have available within your particular system a provider who could offer one or more of these evidence-based treatments. So what are the evidence-based treatments? Well, there are three that are well-studied: cognitive behavioral therapy, interpersonal therapy, and problem-solving therapy. And of those, the first one is the one with the strongest research base and the largest number of studies, both in the U.S. and in other parts of the world, notably the U.K. And there are some other forms of therapy that are promising. The mindfulness-based cognitive behavior therapy is an attempt to kind of blend the complementary alternative medicine approach that I mentioned a few slides ago with the more traditional CBT, and it works very well. The evidence base on it is growing considerably, but it isn't quite there yet to where it can be fully endorsed. Now, in the primary care setting, problem-solving therapy is what's recommended in the primary care setting itself. And why is that? Because of its brevity. Usually a course of 6 to 8 sessions over a 3-month period will be sufficient to help the person learn some problem-solving skills and to reduce at least their symptomatic level of depression. The others require more sessions, 16, 20, give or take, these are just ranges, generally over a longer period of time, like 4 to 6 months. However, the VA does recommend that patients with a history of suicide attempts should have CBT, and patients with severe, recurrent, or chronic major depression, or double depression, which is major depression plus dysthymia, long-term depression, CBT and pharmacotherapy, the combination, are really recommended. So just very briefly, what is CBT? CBT is a skill-oriented treatment. The idea is to help patients learn some simple techniques for managing their mood better. And these include learning how to do more positive things on a daily basis and learning to challenge unhelpful thinking patterns so that they can change some of their perceptions about situations. So it's present-focused, goal-oriented, and relatively brief. And there are several reviews that point to the efficacy of CBT for late-life depression. It might be interesting for some of you to know that it is the most widely used in the UK, and in fact it's the first line of treatment in the UK, not pharmacotherapy, which is quite the opposite of what is true in the United States. Now, in primary care, the use of CBT in primary care, one large-scale study conducted in the UK by Surfati and colleagues found, just to shorten what's all on that slide, found it that the cognitive behavior therapy plus treatment as usual was better than either treatment as usual alone or treatment as usual plus a talking control. That meant that people came in and chatted, but they didn't receive the important components of CBT. And they had up to 12 sessions. They found both immediate improvement and, again, 6 months later. And this was an important study because it really pointed to the specificity of effect of the CBT itself. On the national scale, the VA has a CBT training initiative that is being conducted, has been going on for about 3 years. It's quite extensive, involves not only participation in a workshop, but also follow-up for a minimum of 4 months, involving group consultation, which is based on hearing audio tapes of actual sessions. Practitioners continue until they achieve a minimum competency level in the CBT. And this is, I think, a very important example of how you can achieve change in the largest healthcare system in the United States. You know, it does require a commitment of time and resources, but it is a culture change that is happening in the VA, namely the inclusion of evidence-based treatments, focusing on CBT because it's the one that they're doing the most training in, but they're starting to do training in others as well. And what is problem-solving therapy? So problem-solving therapy, I mentioned a little bit about that before, but just in case you want to know a little more about it, the idea is that you'd choose some specific problems to work on, problems in everyday life, problems that the person's experiencing in terms of maybe managing relationships with their family or in terms of being able to take care of themselves. Maybe they're not able to take care of a lot of their own issues anymore. So the idea is to figure out what are some concrete problems and then to break them down into manageable steps and help the person develop a plan, like an action plan, for how they're going to deal with the problem. And again, many older individuals really like this approach and have a great deal of success with it, and it was used effectively in primary care in the IMPACT study, as I mentioned. Now, depressed, ethnically diverse older adults have been researched, have been surveyed to find out what some of their care preferences are. So Dupre, for example, studied African American elders. Mui and Kang and Barrio at the colleague studied Asian and Latino elders. And in general, they found what Dr. Hargrave said in the beginning. There's a lot of stigma and a lot of shame associated with mental illness in minority communities. And this clearly contributes to their low service utilization. Most, if you go to the last bullet point, preferred to obtain help from their family doctor. Now, that could be interpreted as the primary care physician for purposes of this talk, which really points to the pivotal role that the primary care team really plays in the assessment and treatment of depression. It's much more acceptable for an ethnic minority elder to get help in the primary care setting than it is for them to go to a mental health practitioner. Okay, let's see. Another study that was done that may be that I think is of interest and promising and should be replicated is a study looking at the preference. This was among Caucasian older adults for psychological versus medication treatment for depression. If both were equally available, it turns out that some type of psychological intervention was chosen over medication, which is kind of a teaser, you know. We're not exactly sure whether we'd find the same thing with ethnic minority elders or not, because those studies really haven't been done. But there was a study done by Alvidrez and colleagues on how to increase participation in talking therapy. And it was done with older African Americans. They were given 15 minutes of an individual psychoeducational meeting or session that was intended to help them understand what was going to happen to them, as well as help dispel some of their negative beliefs and some of the stigma associated with mental illness. And this very inexpensive but culturally sensitive intervention enabled more of them to actually start and then continue in psychotherapy. So it's likely that similar programs would be of help to other ethnic minority groups as well. So if we could offer a summary and some conclusions here, then we'll open it up again for Q&A, and that is that depression can be recognized and it can be effectively treated in primary care, particularly if an integrated or collaborative care model is in place. There are many effective, evidence-based, pharmacological and psychological interventions to improve depressive symptoms and quality of life. And even though many of these that we've talked about today have not been studied specifically with ethnic minority elders in randomized clinical trials, there is absolutely no reason a priori to think that they will not be effective, particularly if they are culturally tailored so as to be consistent with cultural beliefs and values. And there are studies in other areas, like with dementia family caregivers from various ethnic, racial, and cultural backgrounds, to support that idea that we can have a certain amount of confidence that these interventions will be as effective with ethnically diverse elders as they are with Caucasians, with whom they've primarily been developed. The suicide material, I said, is in your handout. Excuse me. So let me open it up then for Q&A, and we look forward to your comments.
Thank you, Dr. Gallagher-Thompson and Dr. Hargrave. We now have some time for the presenters to answer your questions. If you have any questions, please use the chat feature. It is located on the lower left side of your screen. After the Q&A, we would definitely like to ask each of the participants to answer the short evaluation questionnaire you will find on this last slide. We will now turn to the questions.
Okay, I see there's a question about the influence of spirituality on depressed elders from various spiritual backgrounds. And that's a really broad topic, I'd say, and we're just at the beginning stages of taking a look at what's the overlay. Unfortunately, we don't often have as much interface with different faith communities outside of Christian faith communities, and even there, there's not as much as we would like. What we do know is that people use prayer, older adults in particular, say that they use prayer to a great degree, even if they aren't, you know, regular members of organized faith communities. And I think the faith communities that I'm familiar with in the East Bay have started to recognize that they have a population of folks who would benefit by this additional information. So they have on their own organized both health and mental health conferences for their parishioners, and they've really been quite well attended, particularly if the focus is not on illness based, but if we're talking about health maintenance and health improvement, that's really what gets people in the door. If you're giving them information that will help them live better, live longer, a really proactive approach, and there's a mental health piece that's kind of embedded in that, that's been very successful. Plus also using the heading of stress. People, again, are often in faith communities able to sort of get across the message when we're talking about stress management. So collaborations with health, with faith communities, I think, are increasing. Okay, I have a question about what's an appropriate duration of treatment and risk of relapse after discontinuation of antidepressants for older adults. Oh, actually, for late life depression, and late life they're defining as after 45, which doesn't make me very happy, but late life depression.
45,
that's the cutoff. If you have, you know, depressive symptoms, significant depressive symptoms after the age of 45, the recommendations are that that's like developing diabetes or hypertension. It's going to be with you. Because the relapse rates after discontinuation of antidepressants in older adults is somewhere between 80% and 90%. So, you know, I usually don't have a lot of difficulty negotiating this with older adults because they are negotiating other chronic illnesses. So the idea that this is another challenge that they are able to rise to the occasion for is usually not a problem. It's more of a problem if they're with younger patients. So, but once people start on antidepressants, I'd say this becomes part of their routine.
Okay, and I see a question on the impact model. An individual mentions that the impact model was tested on moderate depression, and unfortunately it's impossible to apply to severely mentally ill patients, was the comment. And the question is, can you suggest another model? Well, for the more severely mentally ill, referral to the mental health specialty clinic or practitioner is most likely going to be the most appropriate thing to do. I'm not familiar with other studies that have shown that you can manage severely mentally ill patients in the primary care setting. And Dr. Hargrave is saying that she isn't either. Right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, she isn't either. So the referral to the mental health specialist would be the recommendation in that case. Then there's a further question, is cognitive behavioral therapy covered by insurance at this time? And the answer is yes, it is. It is because it is recognized as an evidence-based treatment. Medicare covers it, and virtually all private insurances that offer mental health coverage cover it. In fact, they only, most of them, including Medicare, only cover evidence-based treatments when it comes to talking therapies. There was a question about accessing the video. Since the video was hard to see, we realized that, and it did stop and start. So
there.
Okay, we hope that those of you that want the video will contact Marion, and she will be able to tell you how to get it, more details about it. It was, I believe it was free of charge. I honestly don't remember whether it was or it wasn't, but it was relatively easy to obtain. So there do not seem to be any other questions. It's of 1 minute before two, so if there are other there is a comment here. Let me just finish with the video discussion. So the cost of the video is $35, apparently, if you wished to own it. But Marion Jang, who's our Stanford Geriatric Education Center program coordinator, will be able to give you ordering information if you want to obtain a copy for your own use. Are there any other questions or comments before we sign off? Just to remind people that if you want continuing education units, you do need to complete the survey, and the link has been there, so probably most of you have already done that. There is a last question, I guess. Are the handouts available for the participants? Yes, the handouts were sent in a PDF file along with the slides by Marion Zhang. So whenever you received your slides, you would have also gotten a copy of the PDF, which contains the handouts that I talked about. If for some reason you didn't get it, please email her directly, and she will be glad to send it out to you. So thank you, everyone, for your participation and attention. We really enjoyed having this opportunity to talk with you and share our information and learn from all of you. So we look forward to seeing you, or connecting with you, I should say, at our next webinar.
This is Chris Mottola at the Stanford GEC. This concludes our presentation today on depression and mental health. I'd like to thank the presenters, Dr. Dolores Gallagher-Thompson and Dr. Rita Hargrave. Thank you so much for your participation. If you enjoyed this presentation, please be aware that completion of the survey allows us to continue to get funding. Our next webinar in the series will be on Thursday, May 26th at the same time. It will be on fall prevention and presented by Drs. Arvind Motherwal and Rochelle McLaughlin. Thank you.